During my first course, I met this gentleman, Dr. Rich Green, and Dr. Rich Green was the director of business systems for the Pankey Institute. And he was the first person, as I continued to take courses at the Pankey Institute, he was really the first person that helped me understand the business of dentistry. And what Dr. Green would say was, Mark, your dental practice is the economic engine that is going to provide for your family. It's going to provide for your team members' families, and it's going to provide for your community. And so the more you know about your economic engine and how to optimize your economic engine, the more pleasure, the more gratitude, the more appreciation you're going to have out of the dental practice that you own and run and experience with your team. And so I thank Dr. Green. Him and I are continue to be partners in a lot of different parts of the curriculum at the Pankey Institute. And but he really was the first person to help me understand my economic engine. Along the way, I also met a colleague of Dr. Green's. That was Dennis Munholland. Dennis was someone that really helped me understand the pieces of the economic engine that I was learning about and trying to optimize. And Dr. Munholland did a master's thesis on for his MBA on what he called the prosperity formula. And the prosperity formula, if you follow the words across on the left side, the prosperity formula says that gross revenues of your practice minus business expenses minus personal expenses, that is going to be the dollars that you have to work with. So that is your present situation. And if you take those dollars from your present situation and times them by 1 + R to the factor of N, so your rate of return times your number of years, that's going to be your future situation. So if you understand the prosperity formula, you realize your dental practice and your revenues from your dental practice, your business expenses and your personal expenses are all tied to the dollars that you have to play with today, and the rate of return and the number of years you have to play with for those dollars is what's going to create your retirement funds and then and those things beyond. And what I can tell you is this really is the formula for the business education that we provide participants through the curriculum at the Pankey Institute. Okay. So, you know, if you have not been to the Pankey Institute, are not familiar with the essentials courses that are there, please go on to www.pankey.org and you can learn more about the courses that we offer. But the business systems curriculum is tied through each of the essentials courses that we have, along with some focus courses that I'll talk about a little bit later. But coming back to the Dr. Munholland's prosperity formula, the first section was gross revenues. And obviously it would make sense that your economic engine in your dental practice is going to be driven by your gross revenues. So today we're going to spend some time talking about the business systems that drive an increase in gross revenues. So when I think about the things that increase gross revenues, I'm talking about three specific areas. The first is the number of visits that you have in your practice. Obviously, the more visits that you have from patients in your practice, that's going to drive revenues. If you take the number of visits times your production per visit, so how much are you producing with each visit, and you take that times your collection percentage, obviously, if your visits are high, your productions are high, but your collection rate is not high, obviously that's going to be a lag on your gross revenues. So today we're going to talk about business systems that drive each of these three areas: the number of visits, the production per visit, and the collection percentage. And in dentistry, we love the buzzwords key performance indicators or KPIs. So I am going to refer to the different sections that I'm going to talk about from key performance indicators. But more importantly, I think what we want to do is talk about the behaviors that drive these KPIs. So it's one thing to know what the KPIs are. It's another to be talking about the behaviors that drive these. So when I think about systems that influence gross revenues, and, you know, again, we're going to talk about the number of visits, production per visit, and collections percentage. And there are 10 different areas in a dental practice that I believe influence gross revenues. There are 10 different systems that influence gross revenues. So under the visits, number of visits, we're going to spend time talking about reappointment rate, new patients, and attrition. Under production per visit, we're going to take a couple of those. And under collection percentage, we're going to take a couple of those. So I don't have time today in the hour that we have to talk about all 10 of these, but all 10 have a function in your practice. Now, most of the time, if a person says, I've got 10 things that you could pay attention to, most of us, our eyes gloss over and we can't imagine the concept of trying to manage, you know, 10 juggling balls in the air. And what I would encourage you to do is think about one of these things that you could influence in your practice. And one of these things will have an influence on gross revenues. So by the end of this hour, my encouragement would be to think about, you know, paying attention to or focusing on one and one at a time. And maybe 6 months from now, you could add a second one. And 6 months from now, you could add a third one. Or maybe you have team members that are willing to take one of these on and help report for you. So those are the types of, that's kind of the philosophy that I always suggest when it comes to looking at a number of different resources in your practice, because the reality is most of us can only really focus on one thing at a time. So today I want to talk about, as the first one out of the gate, we're going to talk about the number of visits and things that influence that number. My favorite system, which I believe is the simplest system to enact in a dental practice, is to be thinking about reappointment rate. Okay. Reappointment rate is what are the number of patients that are coming in for a day that are leaving with another appointment in your practice. So if a patient comes in for a hygiene visit, what's the percentage of those patients for that hygienist that are leaving with another appointment to come back? And same for me in the restorative part of my practice. How many patients that come in to see me also have an appointment, any appointment, to come back into the practice at a future date? So that's what I consider reappointment rate. And in my practice, we strive to be somewhere around 90% or 92% of our patients leave the office with an appointment to return for a follow-up visit. And how does that look in my practice? Well, I mean, in our practice, the hygiene team would pre-book most patients for their next appointment. So Mrs. Jones, you know, we're finishing up today's appointment. You know, you and I talk today, and what we think is most appropriate is that you come back on a 4-month recall. Would it be okay with you if we reserved time for you at a time that's appropriate? And let's go ahead and get that scheduled today. So that, I think, is really common in the hygiene departments of dental practices, is to pre-book future appointments. The things that my dental assistants, Marie and Tara, use, the language that they use is, oh, Mrs. Jones, I noticed that you have an appointment to see us, to see the hygienist Megan, and we're gonna see you 3 months from now. Is that appointment time that we have reserved for you, is that still appropriate, or do we need to change that? But it's confirming that it's there. Or if there isn't an appointment there, you know what, Mrs. Jones, I noticed that we don't have a follow-up appointment for you. It looks like, you know, setting you up for a hygiene appointment would be appropriate. Is it okay that we find a date and time that's appropriate for you, and we'll reserve that time for you? So again, I think it's the simplest of all systems to put in place. And while I have this automated in my practice, so at the end of the day, I actually via email get a report that tells me what happened in my practice for the day. And one of the things that's on there is reappointment rate. So I can see what the reappointment rate is for the day, the week, the month, and the year average. I believe it's as simple as having a list of patients' names that come in for the day and just a yes and no box that by the time that they leave, do they have an appointment for a future appointment. And again, each team member can do things that will influence the reappointment rate. So whether it be someone that works at the front desk, whether it be a hygienist, whether it be a dental assistant, I believe that each of our team members has a responsibility on my team. Each of my team members has a responsibility to do things that will improve and influence the reappointment rate. And there are some patients that we're not going to reappoint. Some patients just, they don't have their schedule ahead of time. So they'll struggle with reappointment there. And there are some patients that who might frequently miss appointments or things like that, that we might not want to pre-appoint. Your systems and your practice may be different. Most people have heard of the drive for new patients. And I'm going to suggest today that I will probably spend the rest of my life in my dental career trying to figure out, the best ways to manage new patients. You know, we're fortunate that we live in an area of the country. I'm fortunate that we have a reputation that is strong. And new patient flow is something that I don't worry about on a day-to-day basis. I certainly worried about those things in the first 10 years of owning a business, not so much in my second 10 years of owning a business. But I think that the hardest thing that we have to work out in our practice, and again, I'll spend the rest of my career, is figuring out ways that we can help our patients understand, or patients that contact us, learning about them to know, do they want a Mayo Clinic experience when they call our practice, or do they want a Minute Clinic experience when they call our practice? I live and work in Western North Carolina. There's a broad patient base, and you know, there are some patients that do call us wanting a Minute Clinic experience, and there are patients that call us wanting the Mayo Clinic experience, and we have to figure out which of those entry points is going to be best, and how do we manage those conversations so that expectations are clear. And in our practice, likely not different than yours. I mean, I think that that most of us are really clear that new patients can come in through the hygiene department, through the dentist chair, through consultations or emergencies. Those are all reasonable ways that new patients come into our practice. And I always say that despite our best efforts, messages sometimes get mixed up. I have patients that come into my schedule for an exam that think that they're getting their teeth cleaned. I mean, this is just a reality. Even Air Canada, this picture was taken just a couple of years ago, even Air Canada can kind of mess up their messaging. And this is the reality of working in the field that we're working in. I think beyond reappointment rate, the second system that influences the number of visits in a dental practice is actually attrition rate. And we constantly hear about new patients. I got 25 new patients or 40 new patients, or this dentist gets 60 new patients a month. You know, that is, I think almost ad nauseum, kind of a chest beating number that doesn't mean as much to me as attrition. So what is attrition? We're constantly talking about the new patients that come through our door, but what most practices aren't paying attention to is the people that are going out our door. So by going out the door, what I mean by that is how many patients haven't been back to your office. And we use a period of time in our practice, and that period of time is typically 18 months. Okay. So attrition is you have a number of patients that are coming into your practice. but you have a number of patients that haven't been back to your practice in 18 months, and those patients are at risk of leaving your practice or not influencing the business systems, the number of visits in your office. So we actually run a report every month that is based upon what number of patients, who hasn't been in our practice in the last 18 months. And that is, and it's done by month. So what I do know that when I pull that report in March, if we go back 18 months, that's when the patient was in the practice last. So we want to make sure that we work hard that, you know, while I might have 20 new patients in a month, I could have 10 people on that attrition list that haven't been back in 18 months. And we want to make sure that we work hard to talk to those 10 people on the attrition list to see if we can reactivate them into the practice. Okay. So again, the focus is almost always on new patients. That's these folks to the right. Oftentimes we're missing opportunities for patients, attrition patients that are going out the door if we don't pay attention to who they are. So my guess is that within your dental practice software, you can run a report on who these people are. And I'd encourage you to do that and have that be part of a system in your practice. Is attrition healthy? I do think that there is going to be a portion of attrition for every single dental practice. If you look at the average practices across the country, you're going to see 5 to 10% of attrition per year, depending if you have an older population or you're in college towns, you may have closer to 10%. So that is just something to be aware of. And there are patients who, this happens certainly in my practice, there are patients that really only come to us for emergency care, and it would be easy for them, to not come in 18 months, and we might not actively go after those patients that we've sought, that have sought emergency care, because the pattern is just emergencies only, and our focus tends to be on healthier, more healthy adult patients. So that's something to keep in mind.
Dr. Clive, I'm gonna interrupt you for a second.
Please do.
We have a question that came up, and it says, what does it mean, new patient with hygiene, to be a point of entrance? Patient may be seen by hygienist without dentist exam?
No, what that means is sometimes we have, at least for me, what that means is sometimes we have patients come into our practice that are new patients, and they come through the hygiene schedule. They're still going to get an exam with me, but how the visit is maintained and who's in charge of the visit is the hygienist. The best way that we manage those patients is to call them up, text them, email them, and say, hey, we haven't seen you in 18 months. Is there something that we can do for you that would that we can get you back in the office?
Great, thank you.
You're welcome. So now we're into the middle column. So first we talked about the number of visits and things that we can do to increase the number of visits. The middle column is about things that will increase production per visit. So here's another one of my favorites. And that has to do with fees. And what are you doing on a conscious basis to understand what's going on with your fees, particularly in your geographic area? So Henry Schein, Patterson, and some select consultants in the country have access to national databases that are based upon zip codes that can help dentists understand where their fees lie for ADA codes based upon geography. So, and if you've never seen a report like this, here is a sample. So basically, if you take the periodic oral evaluation code, the D0120, you'll see P40, which is here, that's the fee. The $50 there is the fee for the 40th percentile. So those dentists that are in the 40th percentile charge $50. If they're in the 50th percentile, it'll be 52. If it's the 60th percentile, it'll be 54. Okay. And on up to the 70th, 80th, 90th, and 95th percentile. So somewhere along the way, I think it's helpful for dentists to understand where their fee structure is. And the more you know about what your care, skill, and judgment, you know, those investments are, the more you know about what it takes to run your business, the overhead of your business, your facility expenses, your payroll fees, payroll cost, those sorts of things. That's how I think fees get set appropriately. But some of you in the audience, some dentists in the country aren't aware of kind of where their fees stack up against their peers. And this is one way that dentists can learn more about how to structure fees. Okay. So interestingly, you know, it's possible, this is a fee analysis that was done with actual fees, and you can actually see, you know, this was a number of years ago, but you can actually see the 40th, 50th, 60th, 70th, and you can actually see the fees for the dentist at the time. And you can see how most of these fees, many of these fees, was below the 40th percentile. So it can be a significant awareness piece if you understand where your fees lie, again, based upon geography when compared to your peers. I think it can be really, really eye-opening, okay? And anytime there's a discussion amongst dentists with regards to fees, there's a fair number of folks who sit in the audience and they think about the last time somebody made some retort about their fees. This is an actual letter that was sent to me of a patient that was really significantly surprised by what our fees were, and she felt that she was going to need to find a new provider for dental services. This is reality. There are always going to be a certain portion of the population that chooses, you know, my best and finest care and your best and finest care based upon what the fees are. That is a reality that we live in. Why this letter was so impactful for me on the day that it showed up is because on the same day, a patient brought in this big bouquet of gorgeous flowers, and the flowers were to say, thank you for your fine care and the fine care that you provide me and my family. So it's just maybe it was karma that on the day that this letter showed up, I also got a big bouquet of flowers. So sometimes there's just things that even things out in our lives. So, so fee structure and what you do with your fees and maybe some new awareness on fees would be something I'd encourage you to be thinking about. A second system that drives production per visit is understanding what's happening with your mix of services in your office. Okay. And I see mix of services as things that I'm doing and things in my chair with my services, and mix of services that are happening in the hygiene department, because those are the two places where we have the ability to influence production per visit. So sometimes mix of services is the dentistry that we provide, and maybe certainly through my time in my education at the Pankey Institute, I learned more about how to move away from doing simple dentistry, simple single crown dentistry, single filling dentistry, but doing it very well, to having a better understanding of what's possible in dentistry and providing more comprehensive care for patients. That is definitely a drive of the curriculum at the Pankey Institute, is to help dentists understand and close the gap between what's known and what's practiced. So all of us associated with the Pankey Institute are really trying to work hard to help dentists see all that's possible in restorative dentistry. And the second part is just doing things that influence the mix of services in your practice. You know, Invisalign or Invisalign type products are wonderful types of services. In our practice, we've moved away from kind of Invisalign branded services to providing and manufacturing aligners in our own practice. So what does that look like? We happen to use a program called Exceed Ortho, and basically it's a very similar process to Invisalign, and but we're manufacturing the aligners and stuff right in our practice. Okay. With regards to mix of services in the hygiene department, what I encourage dentists and hygienists to pay attention to is the mix of services between the 4,000 codes, which are scaling and root planing, periodontal therapy, periodontal maintenance, and gross debridement codes. So anything in the 4,000 code, and what percentage of that, of those procedures, is part of all the procedures that are being done by the hygienist, okay? So in this example, 8199, so 42% of the services that were in this period of time provided by this hygienist, 42% of the total services were services in the 4,000 codes. If you happen to hear someone like Dr. Sam Lau, he's a periodontist out of the University of Florida. He probably has the most speaking experience in the country about non-surgical periodontal therapy in the general dental office. He would say that somewhere between 30 and 40% of services that are done in the hygiene room would be in the 4,000 codes. So this is, again, an example of an early practice. And, you know, the data that was shared with me at the time was when we looked up the 4,000 codes compared to total production for the hygiene team at the time. And you can see my scribbled note on the bottom is 10% of the services were periodontal services at the time for this hygienist in this practice. So depending upon, your reporting capability in your practice with your dental practice software, for those of you that are curious about what's happening in the hygiene department of your practice and with the specific hygienist that you work with, I'd encourage you to look at what that percentage is. So again, I'm able in my practice to see, to just pull a quick report, and I've just highlighted what are the perio services that are happening in the practice and what percentage of that. And if you look to the far right, the percentage at this month, at this time period when I did it for this hygienist in my practice, it was 41%. So that is that those are strong numbers that tell me that the conversations that are happening in the hygiene department are consistent with what we would typically find in adult services. So again, mix of services for those things that happen in the dental chair and mix of services that happen in the hygiene chair are going to drive production per visit. The next system that will influence production per visit is case acceptance. And I'm going to probably spend a little bit more time on case acceptance than the other ones, because I just feel that is a significant driver of production in our office, and much of it is communication driven. So in most cases, and we can ask all of you to drop this number in the chat, and maybe Desi will share with me what's the numbers that are shared in the chat. But think about this for a second. On a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 high, what is your new patient's level of awareness of the current conditions in their mouth? So a new patient comes in, what's their, when they walk through the doors of your practice, what's their current level of awareness of the current conditions in their mouth? So on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 high. So Desi, can you share with me some numbers that you're seeing people write down in the chat?
Yes, I'm seeing 4, 10, 2, 5, and 6 through 7. Somebody else is now saying 7.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. Okay, so the good news is this is really consistent, okay? With the exception of the outlier of 10, because I've never met a dental practice where somebody shared with me that their patients come in with an incredibly high level of awareness of the current conditions in their mouth. That just, it doesn't happen very often. But I have asked this question in San Antonio, Texas, Anaheim, California, Boston, Massachusetts, New York, New York, St. Paul, Minnesota. And typically what I hear is numbers, if we average them out, numbers between probably 3, 4, and 5. Okay. And that's what I see in my own practice. And that's what I've seen in my practice for the last 20 years, that patients come in with a varying level of understanding of the current conditions in their mouth. And, you know, my job and my team's job and what I'll spend the rest of my career doing is trying to influence that and move patients toward 10. So I love 10 as a number. I have to, with most of my patients, I'm starting with a 3, 4, or 5. Okay. So what I am thinking about and what my team is thinking about are how can we use each visit to increase patient engagement and awareness and improve outcomes. So one of the simplest things that I've ever done was created a checklist. And the checklist is what we use as a guide in our conversations with patients. I have a checklist that I use for the new patients that I see. My hygienists have a guide for the new patients that they see and the patients that they see in their side. And the reality is I tell patients, my job is to pay attention to 4 main things. The first is your appearance. The second is your bite. The third is the condition of your teeth. And the fourth is the health of the gums, bone, or roots supporting your teeth. And as I do, I share with them that is the basis of the exam that we do and what we're going to pay attention to. And of course, I share with them that we're going to do a complimentary review of findings. So this piece of paper, we just start filling out with the patient. It's on a clipboard, and the patient and I go through this evaluation form before I start. And then I think it gives them a better understanding of the things that we pay attention to. For my hygiene team, one of the biggest frustrations that I have or have had in my career is patients making comments about the hygienist just cleaning teeth. And it just is like, oh, drives me crazy. And so what I, with the help of my hygiene team, we've created an appointment checklist that helps our patients understand what we're paying attention to, what my hygiene team is paying attention to in their visit. So again, and anyone can reach out to me if they are interested in using forms that are similar to this. I'm happy to share with you what I use. But the reality is I think it's done a great job of helping our patients understand what we do. It helps us share why we do it. And I think it builds greater value for what we're offering our patients when we're doing things. And probably the most significant return on investment for anything that I use in my dental practice with regards to case acceptance, with regards to increasing patient awareness is a camera. And in our practice, what we do is for new patients that come into our practice, we take 6 pictures, and it's actually accomplished prior to us taking radiographs, so that while the team is taking x-rays with patients, new patients that come in, we will take this photographic series. And we ask our patients, we give them a Sharpie pen, and we ask our patients to review their photos prior to the hygienist or myself doing an exam or beginning the exam process for a patient. And what it has done is really helped patients understand. I mean, these are actual photographs from a patient who started, when we give them a little alone time with a Sharpie pen, they start making notes. We invite them to make notes, circle anything that they are curious about, wondering about. And these are the types of things that this patient, Jamie, wrote on her photographs. And really, I think Jamie did a great job of sharing with me prior to me doing an exam, what she was concerned about, things that she had never seen before. She actually started treatment planning. The dentistry that she at least thought she wanted at the time. But photography is a wonderful way of increasing patient awareness, increasing patient acceptance. And ultimately, well, from a case acceptance standpoint, we need to ask the question, does the dentistry that I know how to do support my business? And if not, can I learn how to do more? And that what I mean by do more is do more technically and do more behaviorally. We need to be able to understand how to manage the technical riddle for patients, and it could be, occlusion related. And we need to understand the behavioral riddle for patients, and that is, how do we learn more about them and how we can best provide them with the best and finest care that we know how to provide. Fortunately, the Institute has a wonderful course on case acceptance. It's a focus course. It's taught by Dr. Green and Dr. Todd Davis. The whole meat of the course is learning how to create greater acceptance with your patients. So that's something, that's a course I'd encourage you to seek out if one of the opportunities that you see in your practice is for case acceptance. And, oftentimes I think of the term case acceptance as like, I need to be better at selling dentistry. And I think what I believe that has a big influence are the little things that build impact and for our patients. So the one of my favorites of little things that have an influence is what I call the hygiene handoff. And when I was in the corporate dentistry world in my first 3 years of being a dentist, I would always come in and this is how I would meet patients. And, it seemed awkward for me to walk in the room and have this patient in a horizontal position, but it was efficient. It was like, my job is to sit down and do an exam as quickly as possible and get out of the room. And, it's not only awkward for the patient or awkward for me, it's also awkward for the patient because, this is what Mark Kleive looks like if you're laying in the chair like that. And as my wonderful assistant Marie told me, Dr. Mark, you don't have many flattering angles, and that's really not a flattering angle for sure. So the hygiene handoff, I believe, is a beautiful dance that can happen between a dentist and the hygienist about the hygienist has a wonderful opportunity during the appointment to learn more about the patient, what they're concerned about. The hygienist has an opportunity to visually see what's going on. And then by the time I get into the room, I get to hear a summary of, this is what the patient said, this is what I said, this is what we talked about, this is what we'd like from you. And something about readiness. In my practice, readiness is just about the patient ready to move forward or not move forward. But it's created a lot of opportunities for us to value each other. So me valuing what the hygienist can glean from the patient and share with the patient and discover with the patient and moderate that conversation, and me being able to come in and support the hygiene team and have the patient see a communication that's certainly above average. So fine-tuning a hygiene handoff is something that I encourage all teams to consider. The second small thing that I think has a great influence on case acceptance and patient satisfaction is what I call the check-in and debrief. And the check-in to me is, it's different than it used to be. Again, in the corporate dental world, when I walked in to do a procedure for a patient, this is how I met the patient. And again, it was all about efficiency and it really wasn't much about relationship. Well, to me, the check-in and the debrief, the short conversations that I have with patients prior to starting the visit and the short conversations that I have with patients after the procedure is completed are great ways of building value and tying in the treatment that you're providing patients to their perceived goals. So what does that look like? So a check-in for me is oftentimes my question is, you know, Mrs. Jones, what's your understanding of what we have planned to do today? So that I can get a clearer understanding of what the patient is, what they think they're there for, because that's always helpful. And then making sure that they're aware of whatever we're doing for today and how that fits into their own individual proactive plan. Because I think sometimes it's easy for patients to forget why they're there and to forget that, you know, we're a health-centered practice and whatever we do is going to help make them healthier. And it's going to be based upon helping them get healthier based upon the patient's goals and the things that the patients have noted. And the debrief situation is about helping, you know, patients be appreciated for being cooperative, help them know what to expect from the day's work. And again, tying into the work that was completed for the day and that they helped us with is helping the patient move towards their preferred future. So those are a couple of opportunities that I believe can be focused on from a dental team's perspective. What do you need to accomplish a check-in and a debrief visit? You need to understand why patients are there and the motivations of why they're there so that you can use those and tie those in. You need to understand the patients, what their hopes for are, and if there's anything that's getting in the way of them accomplishing things. This is simple information, I believe, that can really have great impact for dentists and influence their case acceptance. So we're down to a couple of systems. So I've got a couple left. And with regards to kind of the heading of collection percentage, so keep in mind, even if your number of visits is strong and your production per visits are strong, if your collection percentage isn't strong, that's going to be an anchor, a lag on your gross revenues. So first of all, from a collection percentage, reducing the discounts that you have is going to have an influence. So what are the greatest things in our greatest business influences that drag down collection percentage? Probably the biggest one is PPO participation. And I think PPO participation really can be helpful, and where it can be helpful for dental practices is where they have empty chair time. So the idea of collecting $0 for times that dental chairs are open is not a strong business model. But I would encourage dentists. Now, I in the days that I was involved in PPO participation in the earlier parts of my career, I'm going to tell you something that I did not do, but it's, you know, we all learn things. So this is what I would share with people today. I think it's best in the PPO participation world to shop for the best deal, meaning there really is a broad range in reimbursements depending upon the plan that you participate in. And, you know, again, if you have empty chair time, great. PPO participation can be something that helps influence your bottom line. And if you're already at capacity, obviously PPO participation isn't going to be necessary. The big caveat that I think is helpful from a business system perspective is making sure that you are keeping track of the fee reductions in your practice. So if you just put the PPO's fee schedule into your dental practice software, and that's what you charge out, and that's what the insurance companies see and not your fee for service fees, then you're not tracking your adjustments. And it's hard to make business decisions on PPO participation if you don't know what your reductions are. So what are the most common mistakes in PPO participation? And it's interesting that Gary Takas did a previous webinar on this whole topic. So this is part of in the essentials curriculum, this conversation as part of the E3 financial business financial system. And if you want more information on this topic, please feel free to look back to Gary Takacs's program. But the common mistakes in PPO participation is setting UCR fees below PPO fees, submitting the wrong fees, accepting PPO fees when you shouldn't. And probably the one of the bigger ones is these third-party agreements with large providers like Dentamax actually lower your fee schedules across multiple PPOs all in one fell swoop. So those are things to be careful of. So I always think of this from an insurance optimization standpoint. Please be strategic about insurance participation. There are insurance plans. Delta does not happen to be one of them, but there are insurance plans that will help you negotiate to higher paying companies, higher paying plans. And please, please, please make sure that any adjustments that you make in your dental practice software are adjustments off your regular fee for service fees. And please don't charge out your or not track your fee for service fees, because you will have a hard time understanding where you're writing things off, the procedures you're writing them off for, and the impact that has. So a second way that is really common in dentistry of reducing discounts is to think about the impact of immediate 5% discounts. So in the two practices that I purchased in my career, both practices had instituted an immediate 5% discount if patients paid on the day of service. So I'm gonna spend the next few minutes talking about this decision from a math perspective and this decision from being a banker. So I want you to bear with me, because I don't think it's necessarily the easiest topic to understand, but I'm gonna do my best. Okay, so in a typical practice, or in many practices, they would offer a 5% discount on paying on the day of service. Okay, so if you had a $500 procedure, you're going to take $25 off of that right away, and the patient's going to pay $475. Okay, and I think as a business owner, you're thinking, shouldn't I just take the 5% so that I can have my money today, as opposed to needing to send out a bill or collecting the money 2 weeks from now? But again, I want to help you understand the math behind this. Okay. If we were all bankers, we would be thinking about getting any payments versus accepting payments in our practice on the day of service versus understanding the cost of capital. Okay. So if it took me 30 days to get paid and I had to go and I didn't have enough money in my to cash flow my business, I could go to the bank and say, hey, I need to borrow some money that I can use to make payroll and that sort of stuff. Okay. So that's cost of capital. Getting that money is a cost of capital. And if I was to go to my local bank down the street, they're going to charge me 6% for that. Okay. But if you take the 6% APR and you divide it by 365 days, that's the 0.0164% is what you would pay per day, okay? So if it took me 30 days to get my money from a patient, but the cost of capital was 6%, I could take 30 days times it by the 0.0164. And if I did that, what I would realize is that at a 6% cash flow cost of capital loan from the bank on $500, it would actually be $2.40. Okay. So you may remember that you gave the patient a 5% discount right off the top, which was $25, and yet a cost of capital loan from the bank for 30 days at 6% would be $2.40. Okay. So already there's a big change. Okay. Well, we oftentimes think of credit cards as like, oh my gosh, credit cards cost so much money. That's 20% annual percentage rate. But if you divide that by 365 days, what your credit card company that's charging you 20% is saying is that cost of capital is going to cost you 0.055% per day. Well, what does that look like on that 30 days? At a 20% APR, if you take 30 days times that 0.05, you're going to come up with, it's 27 cents a day times 30 days is going to be $8. Okay. So if you remember, you gave the patient a 5% discount, which was $25. And actually, a cost of capital loan, even if it was at 20%, would only be $8. Well, what would it be to actually equal that $25 that you gave your patient? Okay. So how much is it really costing you to give, in a cost of capital perspective, to give that patient a 5% discount? That patient has been given a 60% discount from a periodic rate standpoint, daily periodic rate standpoint. So when you are thinking about, or the next time you have discussions in your practice about a 5% discount, understand that as a cost of capital percentage, this is an incredibly high percentage rate that you're offering your patient from a banker's perspective. So what do I say? I would say, please consider discontinuing your 5% courtesy. I think it's an incredibly high expense for patients that are likely going to pay in less than 30 days anyways. Okay. So I know that doesn't sound like a popular thing, like, ooh, that I just look forward to having conversations with patients about discontinuing the 5% courtesy. I can tell you I've done it in my practice twice. It's possible. And, you know, the thousands of dollars that are discounted in your practice are better off staying in your practice. And I don't think it's going to influence, besides a few difficult conversations, I don't think it's going to influence, I do think it's going to influence your bottom line in a positive nature. With regards to accounts receivable, I think practices need to be understand what their net production is, so their production minus any adjustments. And I think all practices should really shoot for a goal of collecting 98% of those dollars, okay? So if you know what your net productivity is, again, productivity minus any adjustments, do things that help you collect those funds. What do I think? I think people shop every day at places where they pay on the day that they get them. Think of your groceries, think of, you know, service on your vehicle, all those sorts of places. I don't think dental offices need to be any different. What do we do that I think makes for strong collections? We create financial agreements with patients and stick to them. We get signed treatment plans before we schedule treatment for patients. We do talk about money in our practice all the time. We forecast insurance benefits and just for simple things in our practice, like a hygiene visit, our patients have a walkout statement, which says, you know, this is what we're going to do at your next visit, where it says label, that's where a label goes for their next visit in the office. But we tell patients, this is what we're going to do at the next visit. This is what it costs. And this is, In my dental part of my chair, you know, we're having patients sign treatment plans for any procedures that we do, but this is what we give the hygiene patients as they walk out, as a way of just being as clear as possible about what we're doing and why we're doing it. So I gave you a rundown of a number of systems that I think are essential systems that influence gross revenues. Okay. There are 10 of them. Maybe I'll be invited back and I can talk about the other ones that I skipped over today. But the reality is anything that influences the number of visits, anything that influences production per visit, and anything that influences collection percentage is going to drive gross revenues. Okay. And I can assure you that whatever you measure, you will improve. So things that you, simple things like reappointment rate, simple things like attrition. When you start measuring these things, you will find out that over time, sometimes it may be a year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, the reality is things that you measure will improve, and you will see things, you will see changes in gross revenues in your practice. The wonderful thing about increasing gross revenues is it seems to cure all kinds of stuff. So early in my career, I was really down on myself about my overhead and lab expenses and, you know, what I was paying for rent and all that sort of stuff. But as my ability to increase my revenue, my gross revenues, as that increased based upon all these systems that I've talked about today, all of a sudden, a lot of those things that I was concerned about and percentages and ratios, they improved as well. So again, the prosperity formula is to me just a masterpiece. Hats off to Dr. Munholland. I wish he was here today. He has had a big influence on my personal journey in finance. And, you know, just in the idea of the last parts of the equation, rate of return and number of years, the Pankey Institute has a course on understanding financial freedom. We call it creating more financial freedom, which is learning to live on less than you make, learning to understand financial portfolios. And it's all about helping people understand opportunities that will help them be able to replace their income from their hands with income that can come from retirement plans and those sorts of things. So that this is a course that Dr. Green and I do together. And we'd encourage anyone that wants to learn more about their personal financial journey to participate with us. So in the end, success is going to look different for each of you on this path of understanding the business systems of your practice more. My hope is the information that I've shared with you today helps you understand a little bit more of what's involved with your practice's engine, your economic engine. Again, that economic engine has a big influence on your life and the life for your family, also the families of all of your team members, and again, the community that you can support around that.